Okay, my name is Twyla and this is my daughter Melissa. So what I'm going to be doing with her hair is putting it up in our young maiden's hairstyle. As Hopi women, we go through different hairstyles as, you know, as we grow older. First of all, we start off, you know, when we're still kids and running around back then, naked, and, you know, just had our hair chopped off, you know, around. You know, if you look at some of the old photographs, you'll see little kids, you know, running around like that. But as they grow a little bit older, then we, you know, start putting up their hair. There's a young girl here that I had right here. I fixed her hair also. She has the little girl hairstyle where they're just balls on the side. Here's a picture I'll pass around. Those are my girls. And at that time, you know, she's trying to tell me what to do here. And those are my girls. I know what I'm doing. So where was I? Yeah, so that's the little girl's hairstyle right there. And as they reach mature and get to puberty age, we have a ceremony for our girls, a puberty ceremony. You know, whenever, you know, you reach that age, during our summer solstice, if you're, you know, puberty age and you're ready to go through the ceremony, your paternal grandmother, your family will, you know, dress you up, put you, you know, in our traditional manta, and fix your hair up, you know, the little girl hairstyle. And you wait for your paternal grandmother to come. She'll come get you when the sun goes down. When the sun goes down, you know, she'll arrive at your house, and, you know, the family talks to you, gives you that talking to, and then the grandmother will take you. Don't unroll it yet. Your grandmother will take you to her house. And in the meantime, what they had done in their house is they make, we call it a house, another house. They make a little house, which is in the main living part of your house. They'll make a little room. They'll put like material or nowadays tarp sheets, you know, make a little enclosure, not too big, you know, enough room for three matas. We call it matas. The matates, you know, like the corn grinding stone. You know, they'll have three of them in there. And so your grandmother, first morning, is she'll put you in there. You'll get up early in the morning. You go to a shrine that we have with the outskirts of our village on the edge of the mesa. For our women, we have a shrine, especially for our women. You'll go there. And you pray to the shrine, you turn around and you pray to the sun that's rising. The sun isn't up yet. And you'll pray to the sun, then she'll take you back in and put you into that room. And in that room for 4 days, you know, you'll go into the room and you'll grind corn for your paternal side of the family, your aunts and your uncles. So you're in there grinding corn from, you know, the kernels all the way to a fine meal. You know, every night in the evening, they'll take you out. They'll take you out and, you know, you can, you know, rest and whatnot. This one will have to cut. Rest and then in the morning before the sun comes up, you'll do the same thing. You'll go to the shrine, you'll say your prayers to the sun, you'll say your prayers, and then you'll be put back into the room. So for 4 days, you'll grind corn like that for your paternal side of the family. And then when you're done with that, then the grandmother, the fifth day, will teach you how to make our traditional food, our piki bread, and then also our sweet corn tamale. And once you learn that, then they'll wash your hair every step that we do within our life is getting our hair washed. And there's, I think, a yucca root at the other table, and that's traditionally what we'll use. And then the grandmother and your aunts will give you a new name. For example, her childhood name when she was first born, you know, baby name, was Posewainim, which she was named, you know, for towards the Roadrunner. Her paternal side clan is Roadrunner clan. So that's what she was named to. And then when she went through the corn grinding ceremony, by then her grandmother had passed on, so it was her aunt that put her through that. And what did she name you then? Do you remember that one? No, so at that time her aunt named her Tepongsi. So that's her, you know, her young maiden name now. And so after you go through that ceremony, get your hair washed, learn how to do your, you know, traditional food, then they'll put your hair up in this style. And this is the squash blossom style, like you see on the flyer. And here's another one. See? Okay, this here, I'll start with this. This string that we have here, we call it in Hopi himpawi. And that's just, you know, the string that you tie up your hair with. The men usually make this for us, you know, when we're going to go into that, that ceremony. Then they make this for us. And then they also use our own hair. And, you know, when they twist it, they twist the string to get it nice and tight. And so when they put it on you, it just blends into your hair. And so this here, this is made out of cedar. And we call it a ngola. Ngola is just something round, because you can say that same, you know, for a wheel, you know, use that same wording for a wheel. And I was talking to another lady here today, and they said that someone had told them that they use willow. So I'm sure you can use, you know, any other wood, you know. You just strip it and then let it soak for a while to where you can bend it. But the ones that I have are made out of cedar. And I brought this one along. If you look at these photos, and then on here too, you see how big their hair is, you know. And then the young Navajo lady here, you've seen how long her hair is. You know, back then, we didn't cut our hair either. And so, and then we had really thick hair back then. I don't know why my hair is thin, her hair is thin. And so I'll pass this along. This is really old. That belongs to my grandmother, her mother. And I guess my grandmother, great aunt, her hair was really thick, and so that's what she used. Ours is thinner, so I'll use this one. So this is a tool that we have. You know, some people that are really good, they can just roll it up like the young lady here did, and, you know, use it like that. And then, but I like using this mainly because I used to fix my father's hair too. He had nice long hair, and this is how I learned to do his hair. So I'm just, you know, used to doing something like this. So we just roll it up. And the way we fix this is just basically the same as we did the young lady here. Depending on, you know, how thick your hair is too, the himpawi, the tie that they make for you, also, you know, depends on how thick your hair is, how long your hair tie is gonna be. And these hair ties we keep with us, you know, it's not just a piece of yarn. I had to do that earlier for some of them, you know, but when they make our hair ties for us, it's something that we treasure a lot and, you know, we hold on to and try to, you know, keep with us. So this would be, you know, our third hairstyle that we do. The young ladies, they put up with us, you know, tugging on their hair. And sometimes, you know, trying to be perfectionists, we look, oh, we didn't do it right, then we take it down again. Yeah.
Sometimes we have three or four different ladies
working. And, yeah, then when you go through that ceremony, you know, all your aunts, they want to, you know, be there to fix your hair because we consider it, you know, a privilege to be asked to, you know, be there to fix a young lady's hair. So everybody, you know, tries to say, no, go do it this way, do it that way. If you look at the pictures, they kind of like, you know, stand out away from the, close to the head, and this is basically, you know, what it is. It's just going round and round with the yarn, with the hair tie. And then again, like I said, you know, our different hair, you know, the way everybody has their hair. And then nowadays, you know, with how we cut our hair all the time, and some young ladies like to, you know, have different layers. And so when it gets time to for that part, you know, sometimes it's hard to put up different girls' hair because it's, you know, layered different sections. So you got to do this and do that, try to have all your different tricks that you can pull on. So, and then this that I have showing here on the side, the way she kept telling me, shows that she did go through the ceremony. She has that right. And so that's when we cut their hair on the side. And just like the gentleman was talking about how we look at hair, we have that same belief that we believe that our hair represents rain. So when we have the men have their hair down, Hopi men, and you see that they have this cut right here, and then also, you know, their bangs sometime, that shows the clouds, the different layers of the clouds, and so that's what that represents. And then when you go out to Hopi, when you see our kivas at Hopi, our kivas aren't round. They're rectangular shape. So if you look down from, you know, the top, you would see that same pattern that the men have and then the women have with their hair cut right here. And I was told also, you know, that the only people, females, that have the right to put their hair up in this style is the ones that have gone through that ceremony. And if, you know, you without going through the ceremony, you know, you try to put your hair up, and people, you know, would know, you know, out home anyway, that you've gone through the ceremony or not. But sadly to say, you know, the ceremony that I'm talking about, our puberty ceremony, not all Hopis do that anymore, the villages. I would say that Second Mesa, Nanhopi, Supaulavi, Musangnuvi, and Sumopavi, we're the only ones that still have this ceremony for our young women. For our young women, this is what we do for them. But now, you know, with the fathers, the men, you know, having their daughters in different villages, they want to have their daughter go through this ceremony. Go through this ceremony. So now it's starting to go back out into the other villages. And I like that, you know. At least that's one tradition that, you know, we won't lose that way. So then after they, you know, go through that ceremony, their hair gets put up like this, then you know that they've gone through the ceremony, they know how to cook our traditional foods, they can go out and find husbands, and they're able to feed them. So then that's when, you know, you go through your wedding, and then you get your hair washed again. They say that in Hopi, we get our hair washed 4 times. At birth, and then when they go through our Kachina initiation, then after that, when you go through your wedding, then that's when, you know, you get your hair washed again, and then that's when your in-law is the one that fixes your hair. Your mother-in-law, her relatives, they'll fix your hair then. fix your hair then, and that's when your hair comes down. And you'll have it like on the side, kind of like ponytails, and then you, with this, they'll either make you a new one, or you can have your old one, and then they'll roll it, and then it goes down the side. So if sometimes, you know, you see the pictures, the older ladies, they have their hair done like that. So to fix our hair like this, this is not something that we do all the time now, you know. It's during mainly like our ceremonies when we want to show off our girls, then we'll, you know, put their hair up like this. But since everything's so contemporary now, we don't always, you know, fix our girls' hair up like this. And just as the young lady was saying, you know, how the hair is kind of all puffed out is because, you know, we like to take showers now every day. But yeah, if your hair is, you know, you leave it a little dirty, maybe you don't wash your hair for a day or so, and then that'll, you know, help keep your hair together a lot more. And just like she was talking about, you know, like the grease, you know, you would use some kind of fat, you know, to smooth your hair down and to keep that nice shine to it. And we were just talking to my boyfriend's mother, and she said the same thing. She goes, I can still, you know, say that there's some people that still put lard in their hair. So yeah, so that's, you know, some the way that, you know, we would keep our hair nice and shiny. This side I kind of did a little too thick. See how I did this side? This one's a little thinner. And if I had kept this side a little thinner, it would kind of open up more. So this is all we do is just to open it up like this, and then you turn it. Nowadays, we have these nice, nice little things, and you can just spray it on, and yeah.